أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، أبا القاسم المصطفى محمد وآل بيته الطاهرين. Infallibility of the Prophets is the next topic in discussion. But once again, very important, very crucial, but at the same time, discussion with a lot of diverse opinions, issue of infallibility. The first point here, which we
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who whose wisdom, going back to Quran again, whose wisdom demanded to guide us with extra guidance, also demands that this extra guidance, this special guidance over and above Apple and internet should reach to us in protected, guaranteed manner. Otherwise it fails the purpose. It fails the purpose. And it will be not a wise man's job. A wise man will not do a half job. Wanted to guide you, but when he sent you guidance, guidance got lost somewhere. Therefore, brothers and sisters, question of infallibility in reception of wahi and in tabligh of wahi for anbiya comes up. And we have to accept and we have to believe that it is guaranteed that Prophet received wahi from Allah. There is no infiltration there, there is no problem there. And also he conveys to us as it is without any mistake. So that is necessity of wahi in reception and propagation. Infallibility. Then of course, there is a discussion in this lesson. I'm not going into detail because you can read it, it's not easy. It's not difficult, sorry. Next issue or a point which is mentioned about infallibility of angels. Why? Because who brings from Allah this wahi to the Prophet? Who brings it? Angel Jibreel brings it. So what about him making mistake? Now, naturally, the issue of infallibility of angels comes up. And issue of infallibility of angels itself is a discussion. Some people have opinion that all angels are without any doubt infallible. Some people have a bit of a different opinion, but that's again not a discussion for us to go in detail. What we know for sure, that even according to that argument or that opinion where possibility of error in angels, in this aspect, angel Jibreel does not make mistake. Infallible. And he conveys exactly what Almighty Subhanahu wa ta'ala has conveyed to him, to convey to the Prophet. Of course, don't forget that Prophet also, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or other anbiya alayhi wa sallam, they receive message of Allah, sometimes through a medium which is angels, and sometimes without medium directly from Almighty Allah. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay, so that is basically first two, three pages of discussion. Then comes, of course they have, Ayatollah Misbah has given a few verses which prove infallibility of angels. Ibadun mukramun, la yasbiqunhu bilqawl wa hum bi'amrihi ya'malun, la ya'suna Allah ma'amarahum wa yaf'aluna ma yumarun. All these verses indicate very clearly that angels do not make mistake. Now, on this portion of infallibility, at least among Muslims, there is no dispute or debate or argument. No, we as a whole, very
strongly believe that Jibreel, the angel, brought message without any error, without any, astaghfirullah, deception or dishonesty, and he conveyed it to the Prophet. Prophet in the reception, in the receiving, which is very important, talaqqi of why, and therefore I said, in our Jumas, I discussed this issue. Well, Quran is very clear. Talaqqi of wahi. We come to another lesson on this point. Talaqqi of wahi, or receiving wahi, is not a joke. It's not like a normal teacher coming and giving you, this is what it is. No. Quran itself says that if you would have revealed this Quran on mountains, what it says, the right of whom? Mountains will humble down. It's very heavy. It requires really, really a great capacity to receive. Anyway, so Prophet received, angels conveyed it without mistake, Prophet received it without mistake, and Prophet conveyed it also without a mistake. Infallibility of Prophet on this aspect and is there. And that's the point where this Quranic people or sent ones and people stop right there. Quran, Prophet, angels conveyed it without mistake, Prophet received it without mistake, Prophet conveyed it as it is without any. The next issue or discussion, which is very important and of course subject of diverse opinions, what about Prophet beside receiving and conveying wahy? Is he infallible? Is he mistake-free, error-free, sin-free or not? Naturally, plenty of opinions there, and I will just list them quickly. Some people say that he is infallible, he is mistake-free, in tabligh only, you know, he conveys the message of Allah. He is infallible. But in his own personal life, when he is doing his own things, no, he can make sin, he can commit sin, he can go wrong. Yeah. Then there are some people who say, no, in his own life and in personal life also, he is sin-free. But only where deliberately you are committing sin. But by without intention, he can make mistakes. Yes, it is possible. So, not deliberately he will commit a sin, but unintentionally he can make mistakes. So, that's another opinion. Then there's another opinion which says that no, he is only protected from greater sins, kabira, kabair. But in smaller sense, no, he can commit, he can make the mistakes or sins. And then there is another opinion which says, no, he cannot make mistake or commit sin in doubly, in conveying a message of Allah. He cannot make mistake in deliberately, and he cannot make mistake undeliberately. And he is protected from greater sins, and he is protected from smaller sins. But then they say, he can forget, forgetfulness or error is possible in case of the Prophet. But sin, no, not at all. Sin he cannot make. Deliberately or indirectly, intentionally or unintentionally.
cannot make even sin, no. But he can forget. He can make an error.
In life, it is not haram. The error which is not haram, he can make it. That's another opinion.
And then comes the final opinion, which says that no, he is infallible, ma'soom from all the sins and even forgetfulness or human errors from birth to death. Because yeah, there are people who say, I have not given every, there are too many opinions in this report. There are people who say that from the age of Tabligh, once he was appointed as a prophet, he became infallible. But before prophethood, he was entitled to make mistake or was vulnerable or open to make mistake and error. But this opinion says no, from birth to death, from birth to death, there is no mistakes or haram or sins. Not only that, even forgetfulness is not there. Even errors are not there. Error which is not haram, error which is not sin, but it does not make even error. No. That is opinion. Fine. Okay, now, quickly. Of course, your brother's question will be where Sunni and Shia stand here. All the opinions from start all the way until only from greater sins are Sunni opinions. Only Sunni opinions. No Shia believes in those things. Shia starts from last two points. So Shia is between those two last. Earlier Shia scholars appears like they believe that prophets are sin-free, infallible. Never they make sin, intentionally, unintentionally, from birth to death. But forgetfulness and human error is possible in case of but then later, Shia ideologies or theologies appears to be developing or establishing this opinion, saying no. From birth to death, not even forgetfulness, not even error or human error is possible for prophets. Which is, of course, again, opinion of Shia scholars. So they are in between these two basically opinions. This is the discussion of more or less this lesson. Now, there are a few issues in the same lesson that we need to talk about it, about definition and concept of infallibility. Infallibility, which in Arabic is translated as isma. An isma means protection. Ma'soom means protected, saved. So infallible means someone who is protected from sins. That is the literal meaning of infallible. But terminology of ismat or infallibility is a little bit different. When we use term isma or infallibility, it does not mean that anyone who does not commit sin or never committed sin is infallible.
can find people who never committed sin, but they are not infallible.
Shmuel gives example of a six-month child. He lived in this world for 6 months and died. So he never committed sin, of course. So in literal sense, he's masum. He's infallible. But not in this definition of ours.
So when we say infallible, we mean by infallible that you have that well-established quality in yourself. In yourself, inside you. Which keeps you. Which keeps you on the straight path. Away from haram and sin at all times. Malikatun nafsaniya. It's a quality of soul. It's an inner quality which keeps you in a straight path. Then little bit we open this quality. What is this quality? From where this quality is coming? Author gives explanation that this quality comes as a result of knowledge. When you know something is good and something is bad, you will not do something which is bad. If you know that this drink is poisonous and harmful, you will not drink. Correct or not? So knowledge is one important thing. A lot of people do things wrong because they don't know it is wrong. They don't know it is wrong. Infallibles have knowledge, and because they know what is wrong, they don't commit it. But at the same time, brothers, you should know that knowledge is not always sufficient power to keep you away. No. Not always. For example, I have given you an example. Everybody knows smoking is harmful. Who does not know that smoking is not harmful? Everybody knows. But still people smoke. Why? Because they ignore their knowledge. They ignore their knowledge. And therefore they say that this quality of ismat and infallibility is not a result of only knowledge, but it is a result of knowledge and a strong will. I'm taking step by step. So first knowledge and then a strong will. So you know smoking is harmful, but you also have a strong willpower to control yourself and not be tempted and get into something which is harmful. This strong will along with knowledge is on a lower level, we call it idalat or justice. All of us must have it. Supposed to taqwa. What is taqwa? Taqwa is that? That you have developed a quality inside yourself that when you come across to anything which is haram, you abstain automatically by default. Because that power which is inside you, that quality which is inside you, it pushes away you from haram. It diverts you, it controls you. But naturally, this strong will and this strong irada and willpower, no guarantee, sometimes can. Perhaps sometime can break. lot of people with very strong will, sometimes they just go flat. And therefore, what Amirul Mu'mineen says, Araftuka bifasl azaim, wallah, I recognized you by collapse of very concrete willpower. When I see that people with a strong willpower, they collapse. I realize that there is some superpower behind the power. Something is beyond all this space. And so sometimes a strong will also does not guarantee that person will not make mistake. Therefore, we add another condition here. A quality which is a result of knowledge and a strong willpower based upon, that's the third element, a special divine attention. So this willpower which keeps you away from wrong and haram and sin is supported by a special intervention or divine support by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that guarantees that you and anybody who is infallible will never make a mistake. Next point, which is a very common problem, very common question, is that if that is the case, does it take free will away? Then that person cannot make mistake basically. So what's the big deal? Then he has no free will. Then he is not. No, it does not take away free will. It does not take away free will. Inshallah, that discussion, maybe today, or let's see if we can accommodate otherwise next time, will come. No, this does not take away free will. Just keep it as a one point, but further discussion will come. Few other points I call Misbah next year, which are interesting and important. That when we say that infallible never makes mistake or never commits haram, naturally, it refers to haram in his own sharia. Look, maybe again the same very big question will come. There are certain principal values which do not change from sharia to sharia, from system to system. They always stay. Those are constant features of all the teachings of Ambiya. For example, lying is haram for everyone, for anyone, at any time, in any sharia. But naturally there are certain issues on the secondary level which change. For example, Nabi Musa's time, there is certain fish you're not supposed to eat. On certain day of the week, you're not supposed to go for fishing, for example. You're not supposed to get involved in the worldly affairs on the Saturday, for example, Sabbath. That is special to Shariat of Musa. That does not apply on Adam, that does not apply on Dawood, that does not apply on, for example, Nabi Isa or Ismail, for example. So when we are saying that infallible prophets abstain from haram and sin, we referring to haram which is haram in their sharia. Why are we making this point that people will come up with question and they say, but that Nabi made a mistake. Now, very common example that marrying two sisters at one time was not haram in the previous sharia. In previous sharia and shariats, you were allowed to marry two sisters at one time. But then in the further down sharia,
it became haram. You cannot marry two sisters at one time. So if a prophet, for example, married two sisters, you can say, but he committed haram. No. That is haram according to our Sharia, not according to his Sharia. And therefore, it does not affect or harm infallibility. Next point is, which is again a very, very important point, and that I need to maybe a little bit explain now, but this issue will be explained next time when we will answer. The next in lessons, the main questions and so on here. Alright. And that question is, sorry, salawat
Allahumma salam wa ali Muhammad.
And that question is about haram. That when we say that Nabi or prophets are infallible and they don't commit anything which is haram, it refers to, it means what is prohibited, what is being regardless, illegal. Not something which was some advisory. If they opposed the advisory of God, if they opposed something which was advisory to them, they did make some sort of a level of mistake. But their level of mistake was not level of making mistake haram. And therefore, still it does not hurt or harm their infallibility. Here, theologians have discussed a very interesting discussion. I think maybe we should leave it for next discussion when we will answer. This issue comes with the issue of Adam. The Quran says that Nabi Adam opposed command of Allah. Now, let us talk about, Sheikh Shumali has discussed it here, but we don't need to. We will discuss it in detail when we reach to that. But just quickly to make this point clear, that Nabi Adam was told not to go close to that tree, but he went. So the issue is that he did commit haram by disobeying Allah. Now there, we say that this command of Allah, don't go close to that tree, was not a command as a master, but it was an advice. Like an advice of a doctor. So if you listen to advice, it's good for you. But if you don't listen to this advice, we will not punish you. You will not get a punishment. But consequences of this story, you have to stand for that. That's your problem. Doctors say, don't drink cold water. It will hurt your throat, make your throat worst. You did not listen. You did not listen. You did drink cold water, ice water. What will happen? The throat will become sore. But will doctor will come and punish you? Doctor will put you in jail? No. But this is very simple. We will discuss this issue. Very interesting, very important discussion, inshallah, when we will respond to the issue of Adam and how he was expelled from Jannah and what does it mean, inshallah. Let us move to the next important discussion, which is, because I can see time is really running out. The next question is, brothers and sisters, that we need to now provide, we have given you explanation about what is infallibility, we have given you what is the need for what's the name, infallibility, why we need infallibility and so on. Now we have to provide evidence and proof for infallibility. Ayatollah Nasba, author of our book, he provides rational reasons and textual reasons. Rational reasons, he provides two basic reasons, and text, he provides Quranic verses to prove the point. In rational reasons, he establishes evidence one or proof one based upon one word, let me tell you. It's a quite a bit of explanation. But key word is one: confidence and trust. If you want people to listen to you, if you want people to follow you and receive guidance for you, you must have a spotless character. If people can point fingers toward you, sorry, they are not going to listen to you. And if they are not going to listen to you, this will fail the purpose of Anbiya to come. Anbiya came to convey the message. But if people cannot trust them, cannot have confidence in them, revelation of Wahy and Anbiya and Prophets alayhi salatu wassalam. They do not want to have it, they cannot have a complete trust in you. That if you are speaking truth now only, but before you lied, how you will distinguish? Let's say that Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam started his da'wah at the age of 40 years. Correct? But before that, he lived among the people. Astaghfirullah wa na'udhu billahi min dhalik. If he was a person with a lot of problems, mistakes, used to sometimes lie also, like everybody else, used to do things everywhere. Now all of a sudden he received wife and received messenger of Allah and saying to him that you are my messenger, go convey my message to the people. Now he comes in front of the people and say to them that this is, I am the messenger of Allah. Will people will accept him? They will not accept him. See, your past is not a spotless past. How it must be? Maybe you are lying to us. Maybe you are trying to manipulate. Exactly what they did. Those who were sick in their mind, they tried to do the same thing. And very interesting, how Prophet himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, based his argument, first message, he based upon that confidence and trust which he built among the people over the years. For 40 years, basically, Prophet did one thing, to build ultimate trust and confidence of the people in him. Nobody can point finger toward him. Not in the smallest of mistakes, not a minimal error or flaw in his character. They used to call him Sadiqun wa Amin, the most truthful, the most trustworthy. And therefore, in the first time when he invited people, the open invitation, when he went on that Jabal of Ubayyah in Makkah, little bit raised on the slopes of that, when he became a bit higher and people were down, and he said, people, can I ask you something? He said, yes, Muhammad, what do you want to say? He said, I tell you, there is an army waiting for you behind this mountain to attack on you. Will you believe me? Not one person argued, not one person disputed, not one person doubted. All of them said, we got your character, we got your record, your report, your reputation. based on that, of course, we will not doubt. We will not have the smallest of doubt about you. You cannot lie because you never lied. You never did anything wrong. Of course, we will believe without even looking what is behind, without checking, without verification. We will accept you. He said, then. So if you trust me like that, let me tell you something more important, that I am messenger of God sent to you to tell you, say there is no God except Allah, you will be saved. He based his argument on infallibility, on Hezra. You cannot trust people. People cannot have confidence and trust. Cannot have confidence and trust if your character is spotless. So that is the first rational Quranic argument which Ayatullah Misbah brings, you know, to that. Second argument. The purpose of Umrah, again, you know, this is all again, I'm saying repeatedly, brother, that it's all connected to our Jummah discussions, please. The status of the prophets is multiple status. Their job is not to just convey the message of Allah. Their job is to their job is to be practical examples and manifestation of that message. Allah did not send to the people just a manual, you know, guiding, that's how you use this machine. No. Allah, along with that guidance manual, that method how to use, also sent practical example and manifestation of that message in form of the prophets. And therefore, Anbiya, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi ajma'in, have to be example, have to be practical examples and role models of that message which they convey. Otherwise, they cannot be role models. They cannot be practical examples. Maybe you say that, well, no, why not they can make some mistakes? Why not sometimes they can make haram, but as a whole they are role models. We have a lot of role models in our daily life with their shortcomings, with some flaws, with some weaknesses, right? I will say no, unfortunately not. Why? Because that role model is a different type of role model which you are talking. Celebrities and so on. This is a different role model. Here, you have a role model who is holistically a role model. Holistically role model. Now, how are you going to distinguish? What is the criteria for your distinction between that here he made a mistake and there he was okay? How are you going to follow somebody? You say, I want to follow this person. He is my role model. But I will follow him on this part and portion, but I will not follow him there. Why? Because how you will distinguish? There is no criteria. Rational reasoning. Rational and intellectual reasoning says no. He must be a perfect example. So you can follow him inclusively, comprehensively, and not partially. Brothers and sisters, I would like to draw your attention on this point to something very interesting. It's not Ayatullah Misbah or Ayatullah Shumali, Shaykh Shumali discusses. Shaykh Sadr Rahmatullah, Shaykh Muhammad Bakr Sadr, comes up with this argument, very interesting, very unique, also rational. He bases his argument on a common sense. He says that Anbiya, of course here he proves infallibility for leadership, which includes prophets also, but also Imams. He says that leadership of any system requires that leader himself must be compliant, as a compliance certificate. He must be committed to that system he wants to lead. Shaheed Sadr gives example of socialism. He said, in a socialist society, the leader of the socialist system must be fully committed to the socialist values and socialist principles. You cannot have a capitalist leading a socialist society, which is happening now, unfortunately, but that's the contradiction. You cannot have a capitalist leading a socialist society. This is a common sense that does not require rocket science to understand. No, you leading that society based upon an ideology, it's impossible that you are not committed yourself fully to that ideology. He goes further. He says every country almost has a constitution. Head of the state must comply to the constitution. And as soon as he does not comply to the constitution, tomorrow we will be on the roads, united behind to say that president must resign. Whatever reason. Let's say tomorrow, Monday, all of you must come. We will be on the road. For what? To say that president of our country is not complying to what? To constitution. This is common sense. The difference is, listen please carefully, Shaheed Sadr. The difference is that socialism or constitution, two examples we used, they do not address the whole life of a person. They address a particular aspect of the life. So if president of a country is complying, is following, is committed to constitution of that country, fine. But what he does in his personal life, constitution does not say. South African constitution does not say that you must not drink. You want to drink. That got nothing to do with constitution. Constitution does not say where you must sleep, what you must eat, what you must drink, who you must meet, who you must... No, constitution addresses only one aspect of your life. And you are expected to comply that aspect in your life. Socialism, similarly, addresses one particular aspect of your life. And in that one particular aspect of your life, you should comply. Wassalam. But Islam is a different type of constitution. It includes your social, your political, and even your individual life. So, fully compliance to Islam means infallibility. So someone who wants to lead Islam should be fully compliant to Islam. Not only when he is teaching Islam, when he is leading a war, when he is in government, when he is in capital, when no, even in his bed, inside his bedroom, he must comply. Because Islam is not only in his office, Islam is not only in his dress as an army commander, or a judge,
or I don't know what. No, Islam is everywhere, comprehensive. Natural commitment also, which is required, is comprehensive. You must commit, and that is infallibility. It's a common sense. Salaam ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad.
So that is Shaykh's argument, very beautiful. Next is Quranic evidence of infallibility. There are again a couple of arguments here. First one is that Quran introduces group of people as mukhlaseen. The argument or concept of mukhlas. Now Quran has two terms, mukhlas and mukhlas. Mukhlas, someone who wants to be sincere. Mukhlas, who has been made sincere. Mukhlas, someone who wants to be pure. Mukhlas, someone who is purified. Quran says that, you know, there are some people who have reached to that point that it's not only their intention that they want to be clean and pure, but is external force have made them pure. He brings that particular verse of Quran where Shaitan challenges Allah. قَالَ وَبِعِزَّتِكَ لَقُغَوَيَنَّهُمْ أَجْمِ. I swear by your honor, I will misguide, I will deceive. Aqwa means deception. I will deceive all of them. All of it. But he says again, exception. Illa ibadaka minhumul mukhlasin. Mukhlasin, not mukhlasin. Mukhlasin with fatha. In other words, Quran is saying that Shaitan already knows that there is no point of deceiving them. You see, you have to please understand, it's a very delicate point. Shaitan is not saying that I will deceive, but they will not be deceived. No. This is the point. That's the point where you pull with fallibility. Quran is not saying that Shaitan said, I will deceive them, but I will not be successful. No, Quran says, I will not deceive them. Because Shaitan already knows that they cannot be deceived. There is a protection. Illa about the coming Muhammad Moses. Because he does not try to even deceive them. Shai Shumali has beautifully that verse which he quoted, it is really very beautiful. Where he says, you know, Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about normal people, Quran says like that, إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقُوا إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ تَعْرِفٌ مِّنَ الشَّيْطَانِ تَذَكَّرُوا وَإِذَا هُمْ مُبْصِرُونَ. This is the verse, must make a big frame and put it in front. Allahumma, very, very beautiful verse, very important. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ اتَّقُوا, those who are pious, those who fear Allah, those who are Allah conscious, إِذَا مَسَّهُمْ تَائِفٌ مِنَ الشَّيْطَانِ. When an impulse touches them, فانبروا الله. فإذا المرسل and at once they have insight, all of a sudden eyes open and shaitan cannot influence. So shaitan comes to them, mas means shaitan touches them. But what happens? How Muttaqi reacts? By remembering Allah. By realizing, oh, that's not right. Oh, no, 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 I mustn't go there. But in case of infallibility and anbiya, masumeen, no. Even shaitan does not try. Shaitan does not mass. Again, one very important point that the Islam makes here, that this mukhlasi is not necessarily only anbiya. No, no. The path is open. You can also reach to a point if you travel and if you evolve and if you develop yourself. You also can reach to a point where shaitan will stop trying and shaitan will lose hope from you. Oh, it doesn't work in this case. You can do it. But guaranteed anbiya at this stage. Next stage will say, I'll wait also, but at this moment we are saying anbiya. Guaranteed anbiya. Therefore, he brings that in number of verses in Holy Quran on different positions and places, Quran calls anbiya mukhlasin. واذكر عبادنا ابراهيم واسحاق ويعقوب اولي الايدي والابصار انا اخلصناهم بخالصه ذكرا. What can be more clearer than that? واذكر عبادنا and remember our servant ابراهيم Ishaq and Yaqub, who have hand and sight, inna akhlasnahum, we purified them, we made them mukhlas. Bikhawlisat zikrayat daw. Wazkur fil kitab Musa, innahu kana Mukhlasa, no, Mukhlasa. And remember Musa in the book that he was Mukhlas, he was purified, not purifying, purified. And he was Nabi, Rasul. About Nabi Yusuf, alayhi wa ala Nabi Nasrat wa Salaam, Bakkadaw, Nikali Nasrif an Musu. And in this manner we have diverted sin and evil from him. Inna why? We have diverted, we have protected, we took away su and fahsha from him. How? Inna min ibadina mukhlasin. He was indeed from our pure, purified ibadina. So, mukhlas, Quran calls them mukhlas. And mukhlas is someone shaitan has no access. And if shaitan has no access, naturally there is no mistake or haram and sin there. That's one argument. Another argument, of course, he brings that particular verse of Quran to say that. Where Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that when Ibrahim was tested, and after testing, Almighty Allah gave him a position of leadership, من ذريتي. Allah give this position of protection to my children also. And Allah replied, Lion Allah, this sovereign, that my covenant, my pledge, my promise does not include oppressors. Detailed discussion will come in the chapter of Imamat. I don't want to go there. But it says in nutshell that anyone who wants to come to the position of leadership will not be able to come to the position of leadership if he has the smallest of shade of oppression. And you know that in the Quran, oppression and zulm include sin, because zalimun li nafsi. Oppression is not only oppression on other, you can oppress yourself also. When you commit sin, when you break the law of Allah, you oppress yourself. So zulm is aam, is general, is much more broader than just oppressing others. Now use zulm ala nafs. Therefore we in dua to my Lord, we say zalam tu nafsi, zalam tu nafsi, zalam tu nafsi, Allah, I oppress myself. So that is another very, very important issue. So he said that if Quran and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so clear that position of leadership does not go to anyone who has the smallest shadow of injustice and oppression, then it is not suitable for a Nabi and a Prophet to have the smallest shadow of sin and haram. So based upon that, he says, indeed, not possible for me to be unjust. Another very important issue is issue of wajibul ita'a. Quran says so many times, and we have discussed this issue in our Jum'ah talks in great detail, that how many times Quran says we must obey. Must obey Allah and obey Allah's Rasul. Unconditional command to obey Prophet. Unrestricted command to obey Prophet. If Prophet is infallible, not infallible, infallible, and if Prophet is possibly can make a mistake, how you can command to obey him unconditionally, without any restriction? No. No, not possible. No. Impossible. If you have commanded people that the way you command and obey Allah, you must command Prophet also. It means the way Allah's message is error-free, the practical example of the Prophet also is error-free, mistake-free, haram-free, sin-free. Otherwise, not possible to be, you know. That is important. That's very, very important to understand. And it's not one verse, it's not two verses, it's not three verses. Tens of verses from different angles saying, follow Prophet, obey Prophet, accept Prophet, and so on. خُزُوا مَا آتَاكُمْ وَانْتَهُوا مَا نَهَاكُمْ وَلَكُمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ فِي لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. No condition. When he is Rasul, you must follow, but when he is a normal person, all that is, you know, basically giving very clear indication, very clear explanation that Prophet is completely, comprehensively error-free, mistake-free, sin-free, and therefore it can be obeyed and it can be followed. Naturally, made a mistake, Nabi Yunus made a mistake, Nabi Musa made a mistake.
About Prophet himself, Quran says he was doubtful about his prophethood and things like that. What about that Quran when reprimands Prophet, when a blind man came, and I don't know this, and I don't know that.
So there are so many issues in this chapter which we will, inshallah, reply them in detail, inshallah. One by one, these are important issues in the chapter of infallibility. We will reply to them in detail in coming lessons. One last point, we have a few minutes left to namaz, basically. Yeah, 6-8 minutes left to namaz. We need to just quickly explain that issue also, which Ayatollah Misbah got as a secret of infallibility. Why prophets do not make mistakes? What makes them like that? About first issue, and that is important. The others we have already explained. I don't need to repeat. Why Prophet does not make mistake in receiving of wahy? Why? What is the secret behind? Secret behind is this. Again, I need to take you back to those lessons where we divided knowledge. Knowledge by acquirement and knowledge by presence. Can you remember? Ilm-e usooli and ilm-e usooli. Sometimes you know something by having a picture of known in your mind. Sometimes this picture of your known in your mind matches the outside reality, and sometimes it does not match. If it does not match, your knowledge is false. I see a few people who are new and they maybe, let me 2 minutes to explain this. All right, it's a very different discussion, but let me quickly. You see, when I say, I know you, Shaheed, what does it mean? That I have a picture of Shaheed in my mind. With all the qualities of Shaheed, how he look, how he speak, how he talk, what is his nature, and all those three things is in my mind, like a camera. So I can say, in my hard drive, I got picture of Shaheed. So I say, I know Shaheed. Now, I have maybe drawn this picture wrongly. So this knowledge can be wrong, because I got what is in my head, this picture. Maybe this picture is not matching the real Shaheed. So my knowledge can be wrong, and I can make a mistake. But, if I say to you like that, I am hungry, means what? That I know I am hungry, like all of you probably are now. So, when you say I am hungry, you know that you got hunger. Is it a picture of hunger in you? No. Hunger itself is there. When you say, I love, you don't have a picture of love, you have love itself there. If you are not lying, that's something else. You can lie to yourself also, that's something else. But if you are saying that I hate, I love, I am angry, I am hungry, it is not a true picture, it is by itself. I am hungry, I know I am hungry. Hunger itself is there, not picture of hunger is there. Now, because known itself is there, mistake is not possible. Now, knowledge of the Prophet in case of wahy is knowledge by presence, not knowledge by picture, and therefore possibility of mistake is not there. Because
It is not that, like in our common sense, there is a man coming from the sky, bringing a letter, giving to the Prophet, and Prophet reading this letter. No, it's not like that, my brother. No, not like that. No, it's Prophet raising elevation, going high and high and high, to the position where it reaches when that truth of wahi and revelation is exposed to him. He does not have a picture of that message. He has message itself. And therefore, there is no possibility of mistake. Therefore, my brother, wahi is not everybody's job to receive. It's not like a postman dropping a letter and gone. No. That's the problem of these unfortunately people. Most of the people, they think that Prophet is a postman. No. You have to be somebody to receive. And therefore, all those stories of satanic verses, all the rubbish, all not 100, 500% application. Purely enemies of Islam, created and fabricated and infiltrated in the collection of hadith and throw these stories that sometimes Prophet used to make mistake in distinguishing between Shaitan and Jibreel, for example. No, not at all. And especially Ahlul Bayt, and I'm insisting, Imams of Ahlul Bayt, including our Rizal, whose birthday they insisted and fought and resisted against this trend of thinking that any infiltration and any type of influence is possible in Wahi. Because, and then Ayatollah Misbah brings that verse so beautifully, very clearly, which one? Ra'al Fawad, what heart has seen, Mark has said, we cannot lie. Ro'ya, and Quran says, Ro'ya of heart. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Surah Najm, of course. All these discussions of the theory of infallibility. Surah Najm, it's verse number 11. Ma kasab al fawad, ma ra'a. Fawad means heart. And heart does not mean this heart, please don't make a mistake. Heart means soul. What soul of the Prophet has experienced? Ra'a. He did not learn, he did not capture picture, no, he saw, he experienced the words. That cannot be lie. Means there is no room of lying there, not because he can lie and he did not lie. No, no, no. There is no room of lying there. There is no room for lying there. Ma khasibal fawadu ma ra'a. Heart has not lied what it saw, what it experienced. This is the secret of infallibility in the reception of wahi. Second point is one which we already discussed, that knowledge, strong will, and special attention of Allah. But now, how it does not contradict with free will, let us leave it. I can see namaz time already, and everybody tired. So let's leave it for next time, inshallah. We will discuss it again and explain it in detail, and also will respond to all those confusions and problems which are in chapter of infallibility of Anbiya. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.